You probably know someone who had a cleft palate or cleft lip at birth. It's a pretty common facial difference in newborns, and it's usually repaired with surgery while the person is little. That's because there can be serious complications if it isn't treated, meaning this is an important thing for us to understand. Scientists are still trying to work out exactly why clefts occur by looking at genetics and environmental factors. And it turns out one major piece of the puzzle has been hiding in a weird place: dog DNA. Before we get to Fido, let's go over the details of cleft palates and lips. The word cleft just means there's a gap in the thing. So, cleft palate is a gap in the soft or hard palate of the roof of the mouth, and a cleft lip is, well, you get it. And no, they're not the same thing. The oral palate and lips form at different stages in fetal development, which means a cleft in one doesn't necessarily mean you'd get a cleft in the other. Both cleft palates and cleft lips are usually pretty easy to correct surgically, and that's a good thing, because there are some risks involved if they go untreated. These include difficulty feeding as a newborn, dental issues, problems with speech development, and increased risk of ear infections. One British study found that of babies affected with cleft anythings, 44% had just their palate affected, 24% had just a cleft lip, and 32% had both. But interestingly enough, not all populations get these clefts equally. Cleft palates are more common in females than males, but cleft lips are more common in males, possibly because the palate closes at a different time for females than it does for males. Rates of both cleft lips and palates also vary depending on ethnic background, but can be between 1 in 500 and 1 in 2500 births, depending on the population. We do know that there are environmental factors at play, and there are also genes involved. There are a few genes associated with increased incidence of cleft lip or palate on its own, and there are also a few genetic syndromes where cleft palates are just part of the suite of things that have gone awry. But unfortunately, the genetics of it all has been hard to untangle. The environment plays a factor, but figuring out exactly which genes or the culprits has been a tough nut to crack. The human genome is massive, roughly 3 billion bases long, so when it comes to studying complex diseases or developmental differences, it's hard to parse which DNA variations are relevant and what's just noise. We can do genome-wide association studies, but they have limitations. And when the diseases are complex or could have multiple genetic causes, we end up hitting a wall, which is where dogs come in. But before we get to the good dogs, here's a good ad from a good sponsor. So sit, stay.
This SciShow video is supported by Brilliant, an interactive online learning platform and longtime sponsor of the show. If you've watched SciShow before, you probably already know that Brilliant is specially designed to help you solve problems and think critically, but you might not have explored their latest lessons on today's most topical subjects, like AI and scientific thinking. To stay on top of quickly evolving stuff like that, Brilliant regularly updates their lessons, giving you new stuff to learn, even if you checked them out last time they sponsored a SciShow video. You can jump back in or get started for free at brilliant.org/scishow, the QR code on screen, or the link in the description of the video. You'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription.
We're specifically talking about Turkish pointers, aka chattelburun. They're also sometimes called a forked nose hunter because, well, you know. They're multifunction hunting dogs, good as sight dogs, pointers, and scent hounds. It's not clear when the split nose became part of the breed standard, or even, like, why. Some people seem to think it helps them with tracking a scent, but the jury's still out on that. But what these dogs can do is help us understand the genetics of cleft lips and palates. See, the way that a doggy snout develops in utero is basically the same as it is for humans. Ours are just shorter and a little bit less furry. But okay, why should we be using dogs for this instead of something more closely related to us, like chimps or something? Well, the answer is inbreeding. Because dog breeds like the Turkish Pointer are so rare, they basically have to be a bit inbred to keep the traits going. So they don't have much genetic diversity across the whole population. And that essentially cuts out the noise problem of our messy, diverse human genome. To learn about the genes involved in facial development, a team of researchers did a big genome study on over 2,000 dogs. Specifically, they wanted to compare average breeds to those with distinctive craniofacial features, including Turkish pointers. They identified one of the genes that controls the formation of the Turkish pointer's signature snout, a variant of PDGFRA. PDGFRA stands for platelet-derived growth factor receptor alpha, and it plays a critical role in mammal development. And alterations to this gene in humans are associated with all kinds of defects, from cleft lips to spina bifida. And tweaks to this gene seem to result in split noses in other dogs too, not just the Turkish pointers. The researchers found one mixed breed dog with no Turkish pointer DNA who had a forked nose, and a variation in the PDGFRA gene. Oddly enough, even though we know that these mutations happen and that they affect the snout formation, we're not sure what the mutation actually means for the protein's structure or its function. Funnily enough, the Turkish pointer isn't the only dog breed with a signature snout. There is a breed called the Pachon Navarro from Spain that has the forked noses too. Unfortunately, the researchers weren't able to get DNA from this breed for their study, but they point out that cleft palates are pretty common in this breed, in addition to the split noses. We know that variants in the PDGFRA gene in humans have been associated with cleft palate before, but they're what's called non-penetrant. That means when a variation is present, it doesn't necessarily mean a certain trait will manifest, just that sometimes there's a higher likelihood. Similar to how mutations on the BRCA1 gene give someone a higher risk of breast cancer, but it's not a guarantee. Variants in the PDGFRA gene are more common in people with cleft palate than people without it. Like I said, PDGFRA does a bunch of things in human development, so trying to understand how all the different variants of PDGFRA, along with dozens of other gene variations, all contribute to this one part of human development gets messy. In dogs, the link between this genotype and phenotype is much clearer. Mutation in PDGFRA gene leads to forked nose. Midline closure of the nose is developmentally part of the same pathway as palate and lip formation in the embryo. All the dogs they looked at were heterozygous, meaning they had one normal PDGFRA gene and one with the variation. PDGFRA's job is important, so you'd need some of the normal version of the protein to make it through development, but having one mutated form was sufficient to fork those noses. Different variants of a gene can have different functionality, so understanding what happens in dogs with this version of PDGFRA could tell us more about its role in development, and hence what it might be up to in human palate formation. Finding this gene variant provides another clue about facial formation in development, even though it's not the only gene involved. This knowledge may ultimately help with prevention, treatment, and prognosis of cleft lip and cleft palate in humans. And it doesn't stop at just one gene. One aim of the research in dog populations with less genetic variation was to find genetic hints for human traits and diseases more broadly. So helping us unlock the secrets of cleft lips and palates is just another way that dogs can put a smile on our faces.